you can reduce the file size of an image by removing the number of bits you need to represent each the colours, and if you remove the number of bits, you have less colours you can display, so the image looks worse. If you've got 8 bits, you've got 256 levels of grey or levels of each colour. If you've got 4 bits, you've only got 16. If you've got 1 bit, you've either got black or white. And so what dithering is dithering is an attempt to simulate those extra grey scales. Let's keep it to grey scales for the purpose of this video. Just using black and white pixels or whatever colours you've got. And again, for this video, we'll just keep it to either having a black or a white pixel. So quite often computers, certainly early screens, or even these days with printing, they can either display a pixel or they can't display it. It can either be black or it can be white. Let's take this to the extreme, because it basically is the same even if you have got more colours. Let's assume that we've got a display that can either display a black pixel or a white pixel. It might be a printer, it might be a sort of very, very simple video display of some sort, particularly the sort you'd find on, say, an early 80s computer or something, although it might be black and green then, but let's go with black and white. And what we want to do is to be able to display images that are continuous tone. So they don't just have black or white. We go from black through greys to white. And again, you could extrapolate this out to different colors. And so you need some way of mapping the greys into black and white. A naive way we could do this, we've got an image, let's say it's a photograph, let's say it's this video, I'm sure I'll apply the special effects to make it look this, and we need to convert it to black and white, is we could say anything below a certain level will make black, anything above a certain level will make white. So we can do that. And if you do that, you can pick the level at which you make that switch, you end up with an effect like this, where you can sort of see it, Steve, but realistically you've got lots of white and lots of black. Cool for a special effect, but not useful for watching or printing things. So that's a naive approach. It's actually a problem that's existed for years. Newspapers or printing in general has had this problem pretty much since photography was invented in the 1800s. And the way they get around it is that they convert the image into a series of dots. Actually, this was originally done optically. The image that they wanted to print was put in front of a camera, and a screen was put in front of it of lots and lots of small things, and then it was re-photographed with a very high contrast. And what happened was, where the holes in the screen were, you got very small pin pricks of light that, depending on how bright they were, made bigger or smaller discs on the photographic plate, and that's what was printed. So we need to do the same thing on our computer. One way to look at it, if we wanted to, say, make this square grey, if we wanted to make it black, then we could just colour in all the pixels. So we can either have it as white or black. But we can also make it appear grey, just like the newspaper did, by not colouring all the squares in. So we can make it appear grey by colouring in this one and then colouring in this one like this. And if you do that, and you do that for enough of them next to each other, if you zoomed out from that, then it would look about 50% grey. You could do a lighter grey by just setting one pixel of those four in each one. And just to finish it off, we could create a darker grey by filling in all but one of the pixels. We can create, just with a 2x2 grid of pixels, a white one, a black one, 50% grey, probably around 25% grey, and around 75% grey. So we can get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different levels of grey just by using a 2x2 grid and selectively colouring in the pixels. What's actually happening is that your eye is acting like a sort of optical low-pass filter, and when it's slightly far enough away, you stop seeing the individual pixels and you just see the sort of average grey from the number of things that are in there. You're sort of converting the high frequency off and ons of the image into a grayscale because you're looking at it from a distance and so on. So that's what dithering effectively is. It's choosing a pattern of white and black dots to create the image, to create the grey, or to simulate the grey is perhaps a better way of saying it. Now, how do we do that in a computer? Now, if we think about an image, the image, if we've sampled it, is broken up into pixels, and then they have a number associated with it which say how bright they are. Let's say 0 is black, 255 is fully white. So what we could do is say, well, let's say they're 50% grey. Let's say they're all 50% grey. So let's say this is 128. This is 128, that's 128, that's 128, and so on. So how do I programmatically convert that grid, which is 50% grey, into the grid I've got here, where I say, oh, okay, I want that one on, I want that one off, I want that one on, I want that one off. So we could do it by pattern matching. We could look at this and say, okay, these four pixels here are all 128, therefore we need to draw that pattern in it. And these four are all 64, that'd be 25% grey, so we'll draw that pattern of pixels in it. You could do it like that. But there's actually a clever way you can actually do this. Let's draw out a grid of the 4x4 here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, if this pixel is greater than 0, I will set it. If the value in the pixel is greater than 64, I will set that pixel. If it is greater than 128, I will set that pixel. And if it is greater than 192, I will set that pixel. Okay, so these are each of our individual pixels. So I go back to my pixels here, and I start with this one. Is 128 greater than 64?
Yes.
Right, so we colour that in.
We're at my level again here of math.
Yeah. We now move on to the next pixel. Is 128 greater than 128?
No.
Note that, we leave that there. Is 128 greater than the next one? Well, there isn't the next one, so we go back to the beginning. Greater than 64?
Yes.
We set that again. And now we're going across here. Is 128 greater than 128?
No.
So we leave that blank. So now we come down onto line two and we do the same thing with the second line here. Is 128 greater than 192?
No.
Right, okay, we leave it. Is 128 greater than zero?
Yes.
Okay, so we get the program to set this pixel here. Is it greater than 192? No. Is it greater than zero? Yes. And so we set that one there like that. And we're back here and we do the same thing. Is it greater than 128? And then no, yes, no, no, yes, no. And what happens is that you end up creating the pattern we'd come up here before just by applying that thing there. Okay, let's try that again. And we'll do it a bit quicker this time. Let's say that these are all 24. So what happens? Well, we do exactly the same thing. We apply this. Is 24 greater than 64? No, we leave it. Is 24 greater than 128? No. Is 24 greater than 64? No. Is 24 greater than 128? No. Is 24 greater than 192? No. Is 24 greater than 0? Yes. So we fill that in. Is 24 greater than 192? No. 0? Yes. And now I shall go the same faster. Do no, 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 yes. No, no, yes. And so we've created the pattern that we had for the line grid. Okay, it's come up in a different position in that we had it in the top left, but it's coming in the other. That doesn't make any difference to how it would look to our eye, it's just where the dots are positioned. And so we've got something that we can now apply programmatically to create these five different patterns to the image. So we can take our image, run that over it, and create the same thing. We get a nice fine series of dots. But the problem with this is that we've only got five different colors. Black, dark grey, mid-grey, light grey, white. What happens if we wanted more colours? Well, the way we could do that is make this matrix bigger and use a number of things. But the problem with that is if we do that, we have to trade off the resolution of our image because the dots will become bigger. To illustrate that, I'm going to jump away from the paper to my laptop because what I've done, I have created a little video which takes the image from white to black. So if we play it, this is grayscale, so it goes from white to black over the course of 10 seconds, 255 or 256 frames. I then exported this as a target image sequence, ran it through a program which applies the same algorithm, but this time using an 8x8 grid. And because I did it at a low resolution, we can actually see the dots and so on. So if we play the same video, this time it's half-toned, we can see that the way it's doing it is that the dots are getting bigger and bigger until eventually you end up with a completely black screen. But whereas before, when we got to 50% grey, we had relatively small pixels, it was one pixel on, one pixel off, we've now got four pixels on, four pixels off, and bigger squares. So we've got dots that we can see, just like the dots in the newspaper, we can actually start to see the individual dots, but we still get that effect as if the image is getting darker as we go through it. And in fact, if Sean were to sort of point his camera at it, if he gets it out of focus enough, the camera will act as a low-pass filter and you should see it go from light white to dark grey. But it is still a collection of dots next to each other. So that's one way that we can dither an image. We can sort of apply a regular pattern, an ordered pattern, this is an ordered dither, we'd call this, to the image and convert the individual pixels into black and white dots to create the grey scales. So it's mid-grey. We can either set it to be white, 255, or black, 0. So we choose the one which is closer. So in this case, the closest one would be to leave it as white, 255,